Good morning and welcome to Thinking About the Bible. And we're looking at Genesis chapter 1 and really going to look at chapter 1 verse 2 again. The earth was formless and empty, and darkness covered the deep waters, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the surface of the waters. We've talked about how that, for us as Christians, is a marker that might point us to the consideration of the Trinity, the Holy Spirit. But again, when we look back at the original audience, the real issue there was monotheism. There was a plethora of pagan false gods that the Israelites were confronted with. And so to introduce the idea of Trinity at this point would have been confusing. Much of what God has for his people, we see developed over time. Just indeed, the message of salvation in the eternal Son, Jesus Christ, is something that has that developed over time and was introduced there. It will be, we'll see that here, introduced in Genesis in the early, very early history of humanity. But it was not fully developed or fully understood until the coming of Jesus the Christ. Likewise, the idea of Trinity, the doctrine or the truth of Trinity, it's not really introduced here. This is more like a great wind that was permeated by the power and presence of God, was hovering or was over the face of the deep. That's more of what is being conveyed to the original audience. Not this is the third person of the Trinity. That isn't what they would have understood this as. So we have a desert and a wasteland, and we talked about chaos the other day and how that's really God's indifferent toward chaos in the sense that it's not something that is troubling to him. And that's why this was done this way. And this is how God dealt with which would have been defined as chaos by the original audience. How he dealt with that was His presence was manifest in this powerful wind that's permeated by the supernatural power of God. And as the Israelites, this was written by Moses and given to the Israelites when they came out of Egypt. This was probably common lore, but it was until Moses wrote it down. It wasn't something that they would be able to have access to in this form. So one of the things that we need to realize is that God wanted to impress upon the people, the children of Israel, is that he is present even in the midst of these difficulties. They didn't really grasp that well, did they? I mean, you look at the story of the children of Israel coming out of Egypt and they complain constantly. They're always saying, well, what about this? What about that? This isn't working. We would have been better to have died in Egypt than to come out here and die. But this account is telling them that God's power and presence is evident in these, you could say, natural phenomena. I mean, obviously it's not particularly natural for the Red Sea to part, but that great wind that came is not unlike the great wind that was there on the day of creation, the first day of God beginning to form and to change what he had brought into being. So that's the message they wanted to be, or that God wanted them to be aware of. Just as he was there and working in creation, he is there with them, and his powers manifest in a variety of ways that they need to keep their mind fixed on that. And we can have the same kind of thing. God works through a variety of means, and the Holy Spirit can enable us in this life in a variety of ways. And one of the ways that God works in the lives of his people is through other believers. That's why Paul says we should submit one to another. And what he means by that is that we listen to the godly advice. We sift it, of course, by the looking at the word like the Bereans. But we need to be humble enough to recognize God moving and at work in the lives of other people, and as they address us with advice, with admonishment, with the Word of God, we should be able to see God working in that. And just as he was working, and by the power of the Holy Spirit on that first day of creation. So we'll be back again tomorrow. Until then, God bless you.